Professor Dave and Chegg here, just as we can discuss Gibbs free energy and spontaneity in the context of chemical reactions, we will want to be able to do the same for chemical equilibria. Let's get some perspective on this as well.
Consider an equilibrium between gaseous substances A and B. There is a forward reaction and a reverse reaction. This equilibrium can be described by an equilibrium constant, and one of the two directions is almost certainly favored over the other, and the system will spontaneously equilibrate given any combination of these two substances. If we begin with only A, only the forward reaction will occur, but as A gets used up, the partial pressure of A decreases, and based on what we just learned about free energy and pressure, the spontaneity of the forward reaction diminishes, while the spontaneity of the reverse reaction increases, given that the partial pressure of B is increasing as B is produced. This will continue until equilibrium is reached and delta G is zero, when the system has reached its minimum free energy. Let us therefore outline a different equation which describes how delta G correlates with the equilibrium constant K. As we recall, the change in free energy equals the standard change in free energy plus the gas constant times temperature in Kelvin times the natural log of the reaction quotient Q. We know that at equilibrium, Q equals K, so let's swap K in for Q. We also know that for a system at equilibrium, delta G equals zero, so where we see delta G, we can plug in zero. Now let's move this term to the other side so that it's negative, and we end up with this expression for standard change in free energy as it relates to the equilibrium constant. This will relate to spontaneity in the sense that when this value is negative, the forward reaction is spontaneous, and the products are favored, which means the equilibrium constant must be greater than 1. If it's positive, the forward reaction is non-spontaneous, and the reactants are favored, which means the equilibrium constant must be less than 1. And when equal to 0, reactants and products are equally favored, so the equilibrium constant equals precisely 1. This can be represented graphically by looking at the position of minimum free energy and observing whether it lies closer to reactants or products. This relationship can be useful for solving certain problems. Take this equilibrium involving the oxidation of iron. Given the following enthalpy and entropy data, what is the equilibrium constant at room temperature? Well, let's use our new equation and plug in some values. First, we will have to calculate delta G. This can be done using the equation we already know involving enthalpy and entropy. Of course, we will also have to calculate delta H and delta S, as we are given enthalpy and entropy of formation data. So let's calculate delta H by doing products minus reactants, which will just be the enthalpy of formation of the product times 2, since the reactants are elements. Then for delta S, we have a bit more to input, but we end up with this value. Then let's plug in our newly calculated delta H and delta S values in this other equation, along with 298 Kelvin for temperature, making sure that our units for energy agree. We should get negative 1,490 kilojoules. Then we can plug that into our equation relating delta G and K, along with R and T. Divide both sides by RT, and we get the natural log of K as being 601. Raise E to the power of 601, and we get a number that's so big our calculators probably can't even evaluate it. This means that the forward reaction is extremely spontaneous, meaning that the rusting of iron is profoundly favorable, thermodynamically speaking.
We now know how free energy relates to equilibria in terms of correlating spontaneity with the equilibrium constant for any system. Professor Dave for Chegg. See you next time.